Let's talk about which sword style is easiest to learn in the first 2 months of practice. Hey folks, Matt Easton here, Schola Gladiatoria, and...
Lucy Easton.
Sort of Schola Gladiatoria. You are at home on Saturday night with the Eastons, with yet more port, much like last night. Lucy and I got to talking about which sword styles, swords, which weapons and also styles. We'll talk about the differentiation between those two things. Are the easiest for beginners to learn in the first couple of months of practice. Now, a couple of things to say first up. Firstly is, we aren't experts in all swordsmanship styles. We'll be focusing on European swords and swordsmanship styles here.
Matt knows many things about many different types of swords, and I know quite a lot of things about three types of sword fighting, which are backsword, sabre, and sword and buckler. I know a bit about sword and dagger.
So we got to talking about which type of sword and swordsmanship style is the easiest for beginners to learn in the first 2 months, first couple of months of training. And we boiled it down to the fact that this comes down to a number of factors. First of all, the weapon. Does the weapon itself make it easier or harder to learn? Does the system make it easier or harder to learn?
Footwork.
Yeah, and so the system might include things to do with footwork. The weapon might be to do with its weight, whether it's one-handed, two-handed, or whether it's got a hilt, enclosed hilt or not an enclosed hilt. And of course, the other factor is, are you using one hand or two hand? And if you're using two hands, are you using the two hands on the weapon, or are you using two hands for two different objects? That comes into it as well. So, let's start up. First of all, our weapons of primary focus. So I have two. I teach primarily sabre, as anyone watching my channel will know, but I also teach longsword. I talk about longsword less, but I actually teach it as much as I teach sabre.
That's a cool sword crossing thing you've got there.
This is like dual wielding on camera. I would not hold the longsword in my left hand, incidentally, if I was dual wielding. But anyway, I hate the term dual wielding. But anyway,
let's not ever use that again.
No, it's gimpy. But essentially, I actually focused on longsword for many years before I focused on sabre. And whilst I primarily teach from Fiore de Liberi's Fior di Battaglia, I hope my Italian pronunciation will impress Metatron there. Fior di Battaglia.
I do English backsword, so I don't have to try and make those words.
Yeah, but you don't use the Elizabethan pronunciation.
How do you know?
Oh, that's true. Snap. Right, okay. But I focused on longsword for many years before I moved to sabre. So I might be biased. Everybody's biased to some degree, but I'm not maybe as biased as you think I would be. Now, first up, I would say what the longsword. Longsword is the most popular weapon in HEMA. I'm pretty sure I can say that. I suspect that longsword's the most popular weapon in HEMA, and probably rapier is the second most popular weapon
really?
In HEMA. I believe so, yeah.
I do not agree.
Sabre's catching up with that, but no, rapier's...
Rapier is not more popular than sabre. Think about the proportion of people who want to teach X, Y, and Z classes.
That's for another video.
So irrelevant.
We've got the second video lined up. I think there's more people around the world.
Okay, this could turn into a huge argument. So we're going to ignore this point.
We'll have to do a survey, monkey.
So we're going to talk about...
Let's come back to the longsword. So, longsword. What's longsword got going for it in terms of ease of learning in the first 2 months? The big thing is two hands. And, you know, when people come to swordsmanship, they come to it, generally speaking, in the modern world, not having the right musculature.
Being out of shape. And,
well, no, but not necessarily even that. Even if they're a bodybuilder, bodybuilders don't have the right type of strength, usually, for things like swordsmanship. And, you know, an Olympic fencer doesn't necessarily look big, or they're not going to be good at powerlifting, but they're really strong in really specific ways. Now, longsword has a couple of advantages for it as a weapon and as a generic style. I don't like that word, but anyway. Number one, two hands on the weapon. Okay, so it doesn't matter how big or little you are, you can generate quite a lot of force in a longsword just with push and pull between the two hands.
It's a really good equaliser for stronger people and weaker people when you're doing longsword.
Yeah. I know Shad has said a similar thing in one of his videos, and I completely agree. I actually think that if you're weaker, or if you're less fit or out of shape or whatever, or you know, whether you're male or female, doesn't matter. Generally speaking, for a beginner, a longsword is quite an easy thing to hit someone effectively with, because it's got leverage on it. Okay, we don't chop down trees with a one-handed axe, we chop down trees with a two-handed axe. Two hands, it's easier to generate force.
That's interesting. So you're thinking about it from the discrete motion of a cut. I'm thinking about it from the longevity of the length of a lesson. When you're doing single-hand stuff, by the end, like, you've got people holding up their own arms.
And so where it also comes into it is the system, that if you look at the longsword guard positions, they're more retracted. Because you don't have a handguard on the weapon, you hold it back, you hold it in these sort of positions, and it's easier, more relaxed to hold these sort of longsword guard positions than it is to hold the weapon out at arm's length for a long period of time. So I think the longsword and the systems associated with it they're inherently easier for people who are less physically trained or capable or prepared or whatever to use it. In terms of the systems themselves, however, that's a tricky topic, because longsword treatises are not manuals. They're not written for beginners, generally speaking. Some people might argue, Jochen Meyer is. I really don't know. I don't know enough about Meyer to say one way or the other. But most medieval treatises and Renaissance treatises for the use of the longsword are fairly complex and sometimes quite open to conflicting interpretations.
Aren't they all, in fact?
So, like, you know, if you just go on YouTube and look up different interpretations for a krumpow, for example, there's all different interpretations for a krumpow. It's like, it's not like there's a nice Victorian manual going, this is how you do a krumpow, A, B, C, boom. And everybody goes, yeah, that's how you do a krumpow. Whereas with Saber, for example, everyone agrees how to do a thing because it's completely spelt out in the 19th century manuals.
That's actually an interesting point, because it brings us round to the whole sort of manual versus instructor thing, because you can have something that doesn't have that much of a clear manual, but if the instructor is very used to instructing it, they can have a very nicely laid out way of doing so.
Yeah, and within a club, someone's longsword instruction, you know, Keith Farrell is a great example. Keith Farrell, he has his interpretation of Lichtenauer longsword, and he's very clear and concise about teaching it and explaining it. And for that reason, he's a very popular instructor at events, rightly so, because he, you know, whether you agree with all his interpretations or not, that's a different matter. But in terms of how he does longsword, you can learn how Keith does longsword really quickly, really efficiently. So absolutely, that's possible.
So just to roll it back a little bit, so the good things about longsword for beginners are that it is easy to manipulate the weapon because you're using two hands. But one of the downsides of it is that it's not as simply laid out in manual form.
Yeah. And, you know, frankly, if you can fit two hands on your weapon, then, you know, you're doing pretty well and you get quite a lot of leverage.
You're in luck.
Another issue to consider is the one of hand protection. And
we don't quite agree on this issue.
Yeah, we don't quite agree on this, because I think that a disadvantage for beginners learning longsword is that you don't have a lot of hand protection. Yes, you've got a cross guard, but that's quite open to mistakes and you getting hit on the hands and stuff.
But it depends what you are classing as a beginner. So actually, I think we're just sort of arguing semantics here, because we're talking about the first sort of 8 weeks, maybe slightly less than that. So you're predominantly going to be looking at solo work and drilling in pairs. And when you're doing that, you know, you're still at a very playing it safe stage. You're working to what the instructor's telling you to do, and you're not putting your hands, hopefully, if you're listening to what they're saying, in a vulnerable position. Where that really comes in is in early days of sparring. So I guess that's kind of depends when you start sparring.
Yeah, and I think Lucy's bang on the money, actually, is that when you're learning in the first couple of months, if putting sparring aside, when you're learning the drills, the level of hand protection doesn't actually make very much difference. Whereas the physical, your physical ability to keep moving the weapon for an hour or 2 hours, however long your class is, it is very important to a beginner. Once you start sparring, the fact that your hands are really vulnerable with a long sword or any other medieval, you know, or simple hilted sword, it does become a big thing, and beginners get hit on the hands quite a lot. And that's often a tempo issue. It's not just about the angles and the way that they cover their hands or the way they use their guard or the fort, but it's also about the fact that they tend to, when you attack them, they tend to go and attack into an attack, and if that goes wrong, they get hit in the hands. Let's put the longsword down, because we've spoken about that for quite a long time. A weapon that's a little bit later in period is the small sword, the rapier, but then also we'll talk about the small sword at the same time. So as regular viewers of my channel will know, but obviously I realize not everyone watching this video will have been a regular viewer so far, but I hope we'll become so. Small swords and rapiers are different weapons. They are related weapons. The small sword evolved from the rapier, and there is a weapon that goes between them that is in modern terms known as a transitional rapier, which is essentially a narrower and lighter version of earlier rapiers. Very simplistically speaking, I'll do a separate video about this at some point, going into more detail. In terms of rapier and small sword, they're both thrust-centric swords, but by and large, the small sword can only thrust, it can't cut, and the rapier can cut. Now, the rapier is much heavier than the small sword, and it is longer than the small sword. That means that the rapier is much more unwieldy and physically taxing and physically tiring to use. Now, I should point out that neither Lucy nor I are rapierists. I have never taken part in rapierism or any other form of rapiering other than sparring for fun. So I've
never even done that with one of those.
You've never sparred with one?
No.
I spar for fun with a rapier. This is my rapier that I spar with, but I've never really taken part properly in class.
So
I've been to a couple of rapier
classes. We can't give a massively accurate view on this
one. No, so we're not going to, and you know, I don't want to piss off rapierists, because most
rapiers
of them
rapiers are long, which could be useful.
Rapiers are long,
poke people
but
far away.
What I will tell you is I have been a beginner in a rapier class, and as someone who'd done years of sabre and longsword and even sword and buckler, various other things in the past, the way that rapierists stand, sticking their bottoms out and with their arms extended like this, like we see in Gigante, is really physically tiring. Okay, it's really physically taxing. And this longsword is physically easy to use compared to this rapier. The rapier only weighs a little bit less than the longsword. Rapiers are heavy, big weapons. But they are really physically demanding to use. And if you're using them in conjunction with a dagger in the left hand or anything else in the left hand, you've got two things to think about as well. So I think that rapier systems, rapier as a weapon is quite physically demanding to learn, but rapier systems as well, remember its earlier period, so it suffers some of the similar, not to such a degree perhaps, but some of the same problems as longsword, in terms of they're not that clearly set out for beginners. Is that, you don't know, right? So that's
anything I said at this point would be total bullshit.
Yeah,
I don't
so
know
I've
about rapiers
I've
at all.
Read rapier treatises, and generally speaking, small sword treatises are a lot clearer for beginners and a lot more clearly set out and are more conducive to teaching. So I would argue
I've done a small sword class.
Cool. And I've done a couple of rapier classes, so there we go. And I've done
I have studied some small sword manuals. Very interesting, but it was about years ago when I'd only just started doing HEMA. I'd only been doing HEMA for about a year. I found it really useful and really interesting. It's very light, it's very easy to use, but the lack of cutting didn't feel as swordy to me.
Okay, that doesn't bother me now. No. I mean, so my between these two weapons, I would say small sword is far easier for beginners to learn, for the two main reasons that the treatises or manuals in this case for small sword, the manuals are more catered towards beginners and are more the way that they're arranged and set out and explained is more conducive to teaching beginners. The rapier treatises tend to be written for people who already have some experience, already know about fencing, and they're a little bit more vague, that's not the right word, they're more, they're just written to a different audience, but fundamentally. And then physically, the small sword is far easier to use for a whole class because it's nice and super, super light, one of the lightest types of swords around. And the rapier is actually, for one-handed sword, is one of the heavier types of one-handed sword around. These are heavier, very often heavier than medieval arming swords. And longer, more unwieldy, you've got more leverage to deal with. And the positions that they stand in are more tiring as well.
So of the three we've looked at so far, which would you say is easiest for beginners in your opinion?
So I would say the rapier is really difficult for beginners. I would say out of small sword and long sword, I would say that they're physically demanding to a similar extent but in different ways. But I would say that the manuals for small sword are far easier to grasp than the treatises for long sword. I would personally say that. Also remember, of course, that the longsword is a cut and thrust weapon that is used in a very diverse range of ways, including half swording and grappling techniques and everything else. The small sword, for the most part, is a thrust only weapon, okay?
But and reel it back to beginners again. So what you're doing with your thrust only weapon, you think the complexity of that in the first 8 weeks is less than...
I think small sword's simpler. And, you know, remember that the basics of small sword are very similar to the basics of foil fencing, of Olympic modern foil fencing. So, yeah, I think absolutely that learning the basics of small sword is more easy than learning the basics of long sword.
That's good, because I'm going to be doing some small sword at fight camp. It's all arranged. So I look forward to reporting back on how very easy...
Cool.
But it's going to be to do.
I've got to say, I'm enjoying small sword more and more. I'm doing a little bit at the moment in class. Right.
Moving on to the things that I actually know about. Sabre and backsword.
Sabre and backsword. So, sabre versus backsword. They're similar weapons in terms of they've both got enclosed hilts. They're both single-handed, single-edged, cut-and-thrust swords of about the same size, of about the same weight. There is perhaps some tendency for backswords to be a bit larger and a bit longer than sabres.
A bit heavier, I'd say, in terms of practice ones.
But yeah, but it's not a huge difference, is there, really?
Not a lot, in
I would say sabre is easier to learn because it has a more codified system of manuals, rather systems within manuals set out for it.
So sabre's got numerical cuts and numerical guards.
Yeah. It's got both named and numerical guards for sabre, but I would say that the manuals for sabre are just more conveniently set out for teaching beginners than the backsword treatises, I would call them, are. Certainly George Silver, I think, is pretty difficult to follow.
Well, you say that. George Silver is what I've, you know, been studying for the last 100 years. And the fact is that yes, Silver, the manual is a little bit weighty to get to grips with, but in terms of sort of a club level, we have really got quite comfortable with how to teach beginners the system in the first few weeks, and it rolls out very nicely. What I would say is, in generalized terms, the numerical system for sort of cutting and guards in sabre is easier, but the footwork in backsword, in terms of the way that we teach it with passing footwork, is far less physically taxing on a new person, and the lunge and recover that you have with sabre is incredibly tiring. And, you know, whilst it's hard for a lot of people who aren't that sort of upper body strength to begin with any kind of sword to use one, the footwork with the lunge and recover footwork with sabre is quite tiring, whereas the passing footwork with backsword is less tiring. So whilst yes, there's an overall easier codified, as you say, system for sabre, I think backsword is physically less strenuous.
In terms of comparing them with something like longsword, as we said before, The advantage of longsword is that you've got two hands on the weapon. And, you know, I regularly teach longsword and sabre. And without a shadow of a doubt, most beginners tell me that sabre is more tiring than longsword.
Yeah, because absolutely.
Because of the fact that you're holding a longsword with two hands and the positions you hold it in are less taxing.
And that's passing footwork again, isn't it?
It is passing footwork, although it's not the footwork they're usually referring to. It's usually the fact that a longsword is usually held back
near to you
and a sabre is generally speaking held out at arm's length because of the hand protection. And holding it out at arm's length can be very tiring for the deltoid muscles. So let's move on from sabre and backsword. They're perhaps roughly equal in terms of for beginners to learn in the first couple of months.
Yeah.
They're roughly equivalent, they're similar weapons. The systems maybe have different strengths and weaknesses in terms of beginners and their ability to pick them up, but as Lucy mentioned, that really comes down to the individual club. And you know, regardless of the original manuals, if one club is not very good at teaching sabre and another club is very good at teaching backsword, the beginner's going to find it easier learning backsword.
I guess so. That's true across the board, isn't it?
Yeah,
so
exactly.
Maybe we're conflating the issue. But...
So exactly like I said before, you know, you could deal with a longsword system that's very complex, but if the class, if the club and the teacher have a very clear and concise way of teaching it to beginners, then they're going to find it easier to learn. Right, just very quickly to whip out my non-European sword, a katana.
Ching!
So essentially, I can say very little about kenjutsu, but my observations are that kenjutsu is surprisingly similar to European longsword. It has many similar techniques, very, very similar guard positions. In terms of the weight of the weapon and the fact you're holding it with two hands, the positions that you hold it in, the way that you move it, very, very similar to longsword. So I'm going to say that essentially everything we've said about longsword goes for Japanese swordsmanship as well. Not kendo.
You don't think one edge rather than two makes a difference?
A bit. There are probably less techniques with a katana possible than with a longsword. Well, you know, I've got friends who do kenjutsu and aikido, and my impression is that generally speaking, there's probably a slightly smaller variety of techniques in traditional Japanese swordsmanship than there is in, say, medieval European longsword. But they are really similar, actually. Yes, there are differences. They are different weapons. They are used in slightly different ways in different cultures. But in the scope of what we're talking about in this video, they're actually fairly similar. Right, I just want to touch on sword and buckler, because this is another popular combo in modern HEMA and in historical HEMA. And in actual fact, you know, most people in modern HEMA are practicing longsword, but most people in modern HEMA are not gentry or aristocracy, and the majority of their ancestors, we're going to get onto an ancestry another video about ancestry, but the majority, for example, in England, by far the most popular medieval sidearm combo was a buckler. This is an Indian buckler, so not this buckler, Indian dull, but a buckler and an arming sword. Buckler and arming sword was absolutely the quintessential sidearm set of, certainly of English, and for the most part, French and Italian and German and Spanish and other nationality, European common soldiery and civilians as well. Now, sword and buckler. So Lucy's holding a back sword and a buckler because
that's what she does.
She does.
May have just stabbed the wall.
She may have just stabbed the wall. That's okay. We can fix that. Polyfiller. Product placement there. But she does back sword and buckler, which obviously in the Elizabethan period is what took over from arming sword and buckler because the swords evolved. You just hit me with the buckler as well. How much port has she had?
More port than most people, but less than some.
Less than me. So, sword and buckler, my opinion is that how easy it is for beginners to learn depends partly on the system that you're practicing.
I reckon it's dead easy.
I think it's not. First of all, you're using two items instead of one, and I think for beginners, that's more difficult than learning to use one sword.
In general terms, I do agree with you. However,
I was right.
When you're doing it with a back sword and you're holding them separately rather than manipulating them together in the way that you do with medieval, I think it's a slightly
So one thing we have to say is if we look at, for example, I-33, or as some strange people call it, 133, but anyway, I-33. You're very often, when you're doing things, you're protecting the sword hand with at the same time as moving the sword around. If you look at David Rawlings' videos of London Longsword Academy, one of the best 133, I-33 practitioners around, also Scott Brown as well.
And
Roland Vorchecker also, of course, and he transfers that sword and buckler knowledge. Roland Vorchecker transfers that knowledge to like Viking sword and shield as well. But they're very mobile with the buckler and moving the buckler around a lot, and that's to protect the sword hand, because as we've spoken about with medieval swords, the hand's vulnerable.
If you've got a basket hilt, it's not.
Yeah, with a basket hilt, it's not so necessary, so you can hold the two things separate. But I have to say, if you look at Bolognese sword and buckler, they predominantly hold the buckler out here and don't have enough space to move it around properly, but use the sword mostly independently of the buckler. And when I do sword and buckler, I kind of do Bolognese because it's easier to learn. It might have vulnerabilities that I-33 doesn't have. I'm sure that I-33 practitioners would definitely argue that. But personally, I think what you can learn quickest is sometimes the best thing to do, especially if you don't get to practice it much.
Again, reeling it back to whole first 8 weeks. Begins.
Yeah, and if we're looking at the first 2 months, then I think Bolognese, so Marozzo, Mancellino, Dallagocchi, if you're looking at these Italian Bolognese sauces, not Bolognese, not spaghetti Bolognese sauces, but sauces from Bologna, treatises from Bologna, then I think that...
Offhand strength, though, is a really big thing, and even sort of the strongest people get through your doors when you do the... So I predominantly, at the Woking classes, teach sabre, but I intersperse it with the other things that I do, and one of those things is sword and buckler, and I occasionally get someone coming for their first session and it being a sword and buckler week. And I would say that they do have some trouble with prolonged extension of their non-dominant
of their buckler arm.
There's a few. So basically, do you agree that it boils down to like three different issues? Which one is the easiest? It's down to sort of mechanically and then strength wise and
it comes down to, obviously there's an underlying factor of if the club is very good at teaching a system, their system of that thing, then their beginners are going to learn quicker, okay? But definitely the weapon plays a part, the characteristics of the weapon. Does it have a basket hilted guard? Is it one-handed? Is it two-handed? Is it long? Is it heavy? And then the system in terms of how you hold it. What are the guard positions like? Are they tiring? Are they relaxed? Is it passing footwork? Is it lunge and recover footwork? So all of these factors play a part.
So go. So which one do you personally think is the easiest?
The easiest
for the first.
We'll throw the katana out of the window because we don't know enough to comment on that. Okay, so that's good because we're not insulting the katana. We're just saying we're not expert enough to
help. We could,
but the European swords, and we also have to again caveat the fact that we are not experts on small sword and rapier because we don't fence with those, or we don't train with those weapons very often. I fence with both of them actually sometimes, but we don't train in those weapons very often. But generally speaking, based on our observations, which may be biased, they may not be, they may be completely 100% accurate and probably are, but I'm not saying that. Which weapons do we think of European swordsmanship, generally speaking, assuming the class and the teacher is of equal level, is the easiest to learn in the first 2 months? Go.
This is really difficult for me, but personally, I think it's backsword. I don't
believe she actually believes that.
No, because I do really, really love the numerical system of Sabre, and I think that that's really, really well done and beautifully defined in the manuals. And I love Sabre, and I love teaching Sabre, but I think maybe in the first 8 weeks it's Sabre, but in the first 3 weeks it's backsword. It doesn't have that onus on having that level of physical fitness that a lot of people don't do when they first come in.
So if you're lazy, backsword, there we go, okay?
Right,
so if you're
lazy, backsword.
And now my conclusion is, this is going to be maybe a curveball for some people. I think the easiest European swordsmanship style to learn in the first 2 months is small sword. The reason for that is very codified, very clear, very concise manuals from the 18th and 19th century, and you can include foil manuals in that as well,
because
foil
is just... with it.
And that is one of the reasons. It is only a thrust weapon. And yes, there are disarms. There is a little bit of passing footwork in there, especially with the disarms. There are some weird and wacky and complex techniques that you don't find in modern foil fencing, for example. And yes, you can use the left hand. You can use left hand for defending at the same time as offending and all sorts of these things. But generally speaking, small sword method is incredibly boiled down and concise and well explained in the manuals.
Yeah, but so sad.
And, no, but this is a thrust only weapon. So therefore it has the advantage
people
over
want
saber.
To cut.
No, but that's not the question. In terms of learning swordsmanship for the first 2 months, say, small sword has as many advantages in simplicity and clarity of manual and system as saber does. But small sword does fewer things than saber does, and therefore it's simpler, quicker, and easier to learn. So if you want to learn to get as good as you can be with a sword in 2 months, I would say learn small sword
or saber or back sword, or potentially.
But saber and back sword are both also good options, and in the right club, longsword can be a good option as well. And physically speaking, if you are unfit, weak, feeble, whatever, longsword is actually one of the best options.
Yeah.
And one of the most difficult options, if you do not like physical exertion, in my opinion, is rapier. Rapier is one of the most physically demanding of the European
swords. But is that just because you're not used to the mechanics of it? Who knows? So we end on a complete conundrum.
Let's wrap it up there. And
nobody knows.
Salute to all of the subscribers and viewers out
Cheers.
There. If you're not subscribed, please subscribe to us. Show your love by giving us a thumbs up, and hopefully we'll see you for our next video, and enjoy your weekends.
Bye.
Cheers. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, follow us on Facebook. You can buy t-shirts through Spreadshirt, support us on Patreon, or follow us on Pinterest. Thank you.